we are discussing out Islamic history, and we are discussing out here the rule of Mohammad bin Tughlaq. As we are discussing that he was very brilliant personality, but in history often he termed as ill-starred idealist. The reason is that he introduced great ideas like token money. That means as today, in old days the concept was different. Say for example, gold coin was having actually the value of gold. Today we are also using token money. At that time he introduced this concept that we have to mint coin with brass and copper, and they were having equal value to gold coin. Is it possible that brass or copper is having equal value with gold? It is surely not possible. But today we are giving equal value for paper. Just say whatever currency, say 30,000 rupees for particular weight of gold is there. So I am purchasing out gold of that particular weight, and I am paying 30,000 rupees, that is in paper note only. So whether that 30,000 return paper, that is token money actually. So that's why this is equivalent today. So that concept was introduced by Mohammad bin Tughlaq in Indian economy in those days. Obviously, that was failed because the treasures get filled by copper money and houses of people filled by gold. So this experiment was failed in those days. He attempted his empire to extend all over India. No, not all over India, even beyond India also, in the Central Asia, that portion. So beyond Afghanistan also, he attempted to expand his empire. Now old days, especially for the Muslim rulers, they were having ambition that their empire should be like Sikandar or Alexander the Great. And therefore even Alauddin Khilji, he was also entitled himself as Sikandar Sami. Alauddin was pronounced, Alexander was pronounced as Sikandar in Persian language, or rather Arabic language. Iskandar in Persian language, so that is abbreviated as Sikandar or somewhat like. So Sikandar Sami, that means equivalent of Sikandar or second Sikandar, like that title was there for Alauddin. So same way, this Mohammad bin Tughlaq, he was also having idea that we should carry out same empire like Alexander was constructed, but the attempt was having return of failure. He tried to invade this Himalaya or Tibet portion, China, but the army he sent through Himalaya, which was simply killed by disaster, and ultimately the people returned back, they were slaughtered by Mohammad bin Tughlaq. Mohammad bin Tughlaq tried to increase the revenue by increasing production of crops. He constructed various dams in northern India. The canal irrigation he encouraged in order to get good crops that will ensure him good revenue. In order to control his newly formed empire in South India, he attempted to make shift of capital, as we have discussed in earlier lecture, from Delhi to Devgiri or that Daulatabad. And then he stayed over there for two consecutive years. He stayed somewhere outside that, and after getting complete structure, he entered in this Daulatabad or Devgiri. Ultimately, this shifting of capital experiment was also returned with failure. The reason is that the South Indian people, they were not loyal with Tughlaq or this newly formed empire. Again and again, rebellion and threat of rebellion was there. Whereas he lost the control over northern Indian territories also. by shifting his capital, and ultimately he returned back to Delhi. Today, keep in mind that whenever he vacated his Delhi portion, many natives of Delhi, they came to Daulatabad. But during this journey, they died. Ultimately, few of them were able to enter in Daulatabad. While returning back, he ordered that everybody from Daulatabad should now move to Delhi. So today, whatever the people they are staying from long period in Delhi, they were having their origin in Maharashtra. They were having their origin in particularly Daulatabad region, Devagiri region. They get transferred to Delhi by Mohammad bin Tughlaq during his rule, and ultimately Delhi get flourished again. But because of these different experiments he carried out, the empire get weakened out. The reason, simple thing, that Mohammad bin Tughlaq was having no doubt new idea. It is mentioned by very historians also that he was ahead of time. In his particular time, he was ahead of time. But the ultimate reason, result of that is the failure of his vast empire. He was not able to get complete control over South India. He was not able to get complete control over Central Asia to Bihar or Bengal, whatever empire was there. And ultimately, he lost out the territories in his life. Say, the empire of Warangal. Warangal is somewhere here in Andhra Pradesh part. So there was rebellion. As he was victorious in war of Warangal, but later on, he lost that Warangal territory. Same way in Maharashtra, one Muslim ruler was there that was named as Gangu Hasan Bahamani. That he was able to establish Bahamani kingdom. No doubt that was also Muslim kingdom. But that was not now belong to part of Mohammed bin Tughlaq's empire. Instead of that, independent kingdom was established. Same way, two great warriors, Mohammed bin Tughlaq, taken as captives. They were named as Harihar and Bukka. Forcefully they were converted to Islam. They were trained for different strategies of war. And ultimately, they were appointed again in part of Karnataka for ruling purpose. They accepted Hinduism again under guidance of Swami Vidyaranyu from Shrungeri. And then they founded out a new empire in South India that is called as Vijayanagar's empire. So under leadership of Harihar and Bukka, Vijayanagar's Hindu empire was formed. So this is all the thing they are carried out when Mohammed bin Tughlaq. We can check out the downfall of Mohammed bin Tughlaq. He was the empire. That empire was not supported by ulema. Ulema means Muslim scholars. So he was not supported by even ulemas. He was not supported by fate. And even he was not supported by God also, we can say. The reason, in 1334, because of plague, more than half of his army was destroyed. So, we can say with fate of that plague, or by not taking proper care in those days, his army was wiped out. So nobody was there to defeat him. The army was defeated automatically by this type of trouble. And as the weakening of power, say, whenever we are ruling forcefully, the armed forces are required. Say Alauddin Khilji, as we have discussed, that for rule of Alauddin Khilji, vast army must be there. Then only he was able to control the empire. Say, keep in mind, the Rashtrakut dynasty, as we are saying, the strongest ever dynasty in entire India, that was Rashtrakut dynasty. But the end was there of this Rashtrakut dynasty that in order to maintain this vast empire, the vast army, we have to maintain, and ultimately economical imbalance that will collapse the entire army, entire empire. So this is the problem by maintaining empire with army. Unless and until total support of people is possible, the empire is not able to control. Now Muhammad bin Tughlaq's empire was depending on army, and that army was wiped out. See the result. In 34, plague was there. And from Madurai, the south part, from Madurai, Pandyan kingdom rejected his suzerainty. And so get independence immediately after this. Then Warangal also declared their independence in 34. Followed by coastal states, they also rejected their support in 36. In 36 only, Vijayanagar Empire was formed. And in 47, even Muslims, they were refused to obey the orders of Muhammad bin Tughlaq, and from that Bahmani Kingdom was formed. So this is the downfall of Muhammad bin Tughlaq's empire. Ultimately, he was succeeded by his cousin Firoz Shah Tughlaq. But Firoz Shah Tughlaq was able to enjoy his empire, but he was a soft-minded person. Siyasat, that is the punishment of death, that was abolished during rule of this. He was having some impact of religious concept. The Sufism was also there and what not, I don't know. But ultimately he was something like religious aspect was there. And so he was very mild towards the rule. During his rule, he continued to rule, but he lost the glory of empire. He was de facto ruler. So the problem was that after Firoz Shah Tughlaq, the empire start out collapsing continuously. So actually during Muhammad bin Tughlaq's rule, it was at zenith, and immediately under his rule only the empire collapsed also. The same thing, say in history, you can keep in mind, whenever the empires from northern India tried to extend in south India, they were having terrific setback. Like in case of Alauddin Khilji. Say Alauddin Khilji's empire was there around 1296 to 1320. So we can check out here that 1296 onwards till, we can say till here, 36. So in this particular period of 40 years, the Islamic invaders tried to invade South India, but they were having terrific setback, and South India was again freed from Islamic invasion, but North India that continued to rule under Islamic invaders. And the more problematic fact that was there, that initially this figured out by foreigners, but later on few Indianized or say Indian people, they were also ruled. Say for example Malik Kafur, Khushru Khan, they were also able to achieve throne for a while. What is the problem? Keep in mind that Islamic rule should not be a problem, but under name of Islam, the foreign rulers were ruling on India. They were not ruling. Keep in mind the Delhi dynasty, try to recollect. The slave dynasty, Turki, Khilji dynasty, Turko-Afghan. Now this Tughlaq dynasty. From mother side, Diyasuddin Tughlaq was of Rajput, or say Gurjar mother was there for this Diyasuddin Tughlaq. So he was child of Indian mother. But they were having some origin in Afghan or Turko family. From father's side, they were having origin in Turko-Afghan family. So this is the problem, that India in this particular period was ruled by either Turk or Turko-Afghan. Rule was under Firoz Shah Tughlaq in those days. After that, the Tughlaq dynasty came to end. And another foreign dynasty were started ruling over here. We have to discuss that. We have discussed about that Firoz Shah Tughlaq. So Firoz Shah Tughlaq was patron of Islam. He was under influence of theologist in the kingdom or say sultanate, and certain decisions, whatever the important for state, they were taken under impression of this learned scholars of Islam or the theologist. As we have discussed, that siyasat, that is punishment or penalty of death, that was prohibited. Again, the loan which government had given to public, they were also simply cancelled out. That will having terrific impact on the government system, because the loans, that was that is the main source, but that was also abolished. Again, certain taxes were changed. For example, they maintain the land tax on basis of production, and this way the revenue department also having some failure. Then in rule of Firoz Shah, the army was not paid, like in case of Alauddin Khilji, army was paid, cash paid army was there in case of Alauddin Khilji. No doubt, because of that, Alauddin Khilji always wondered of money. Here, in case of this Firoz Shah Tughlaq, he awarded land or say villages to soldiers. What was the impact of that? That no direct salary was paid. Instead of that, soldiers, they has to collect they had to collect money from the villages. So either that soldier should be off from the duty and must visit that village to collect the revenue, or he must appoint some broker. That broker will charge one third or one half for collecting money. So either of the thing, and that is the reason, the weakening of once very good army. Then he allowed, and obviously by some corruption method, people or say soldiers, they mustered useless horses in the government. All of the reason, that is the weakening of once invincible army. Why I am saying once invincible army? Say for example, in case of Alauddin Khilji, as we have discussed, that Alauddin Khilji was able to conquer Devgiri, and under rule of Alauddin Khilji, Malik Kafur was able to enter in South Indian portion. Then Mubarak Khan Khilji, we are calling them as weak ruler, but under guidance of Khushru Khan or Hassan, Mubarak Khan Khilji was also able to overrun the South Indian portion. But that is the invincibility science. In case of Mohammad Tughlaq also, they were able to rule over Deccan for a while. But after that, the plague and subsequent causes, the army lost out invincibility. And now, under leadership of Firoz Shah, the all over the Sultanate get weakened up, and ultimately it remained concentrated on the Delhi portion only. So this is the end of first Turki rule. Mohammad Ghori established Turki rule on northern part of India. Then slave dynasty, after that Khilji dynasty, then Nasiruddin's 1 year's rule, then Tughlaq dynasty, and now that is almost all going to end. What is the important thing? That under the patronage of Islam, that Muhammad Firoz Shah Tughlaq imposed certain things. Say for example, he troubled. He was not able to exempt Brahmins from paying jizya. As we have discussed, he stopped siyasat. But one Brahmin was mercilessly killed on road only for preaching something to a Muslim person. So like that, he encouraged the Islam, he tried to encourage Islam by suppressing Hinduism. That was the major reason. The failure was there for Firoz Shah Tughlaq. He was not able to impose the Islam. Say for example, all of the paintings in his palace, he erased out. Why? Because Islam is against this type of painting. And so, certain concepts, they were under impression of these ulemas, or say under impression of these theological people. And because of that, the empire lost out the glory of empire. Say, no doubt that under rule of Mohammad Tughlaq, there was some glory for this empire. Under rule of Alauddin Khilji, there was some glory. But under rule of Firoz Shah Tughlaq, there was no glory for the empire. Instead of that, Firoz Shah Tughlaq became rich and rich. He purchased lots of slaves. And he appointed them as soldiers, as their bodyguards, to protect himself. And therefore, he was able to rule for long. So this is the rule of Mohammad Tughlaq from 25 to 51. And after Mohammad Tughlaq, till 88, that means 51 to 88, it was rule of Firoz Shah Tughlaq. He worked as if he has given a contract to destroy the Sultanate. And ultimately that Sultanate remains in small territory of Delhi. All over India glory, they lost out, followed by the regional supremacy again. But keep in mind, in this regional supremacy, local chieftain become dominant now. And again, that means history repeats. I am telling again and again that history repeats. Again, there is threat of Mongol. So we have discussed, just we have to count out the number of threats of Mongol from known history. As we have discussed about Mongol, the first, that was Hunnic invasion on India, that was under leadership when Skandagupta was ruling, the somewhat last, towards end of the dynasty, these rulers were ruling. So Skandagupta was prince, then first attack of Hun, after 50 years, second attack of Hun, where Skandagupta was emperor. Then onwards, Hun settled over here and we absorbed them in our society. Most of the Rajput clans are having doubt that they are having origin from Hun people also. Certain Gotra means the origin of Rajput people, they are having Hun as name. Then Gurjar Pratihar rule, that was there. Again, for few years, there was no Mongol attack, but under leadership of Genghis Khan, as we have discussed, that Genghis Khan, he also invaded certain parts of northern India, especially northwest frontier region. Then, again and again, Mongols were attacking. So under rule of Firoz Shah, under rule of Jalaluddin Khilji, under rule of Alauddin Khilji, under rule of Alauddin Khilji two times, under rule of Balban, and again, the Mongol invasion were going on. No doubt, all of the Mongol invaders were completely failed when Islamic rule was there. This is the fact. Say for example, before Islamic rule, Skandagupta was able to defeat first Hunnic attack. The second Hunnic attack was not defeated. And ultimately, under rule of Yashodharma, a confederation was formed and Hun attack was destroyed. But in case of this Islamic rule from Balban or Iltutmish till this Firoz Shah Tughlaq, almost all Mongol invaders were defeated. But this is something like viral infection, that when viral infection is there on body, initially body is troubled and later on our body is producing antibody and these viruses get, say, deactivated. I'm not saying killed, they get deactivated. But till that, whatever destruction is carried out that is there. So same way, the Huns, they were able to pass Khyber Pass and ultimately reach till Delhi. Under Alauddin's leadership also, Kutluk Khwaja, a Mongol invader, along with 2 lakhs army, was able to reach till Delhi, and then he was defeated. Targhee, he was also defeated when Alauddin Khilji was ruling. But he was able to enter in Punjab, and from Punjab only he was defeated. Now, a great personality in the history, obviously great means very, very, very cruel. He was called as Taimur. He was also Mongol. He was called as Taimur Lung, or he was called as, in English, we are calling as Tamerlan. So this Taimur or Tamerlan or Taimur Lung, he invaded India. He was also Mongol. He was some connected with Genghis Khan. No doubt, he was very able general. He was very cruel. And the Central Asia was terrifically threatened by this Taimur Lung. And now this such a great personality entered in India. Now before entering in India, he was converted to Muslim. Keep in mind, earlier life of Taimur Lung was non-Muslim. Then onwards, he was Taimur Lung attacked India from this part, and by giving terrible trouble, he was able to reach till Delhi. And then he simply plundered Delhi. Order of general slaughter was also given in Delhi, and mercilessly he destroyed the people of Delhi. This was terrible attack of Mongol. So the repeated attacks weakened out the Sultanate which was present on Delhi throne. And now this is the evidence that ultimately Mongols were able to reach in Delhi. Before that they were able to reach till Delhi, but now they entered in Delhi. They mercilessly sacked out Delhi, and ultimately Taimur Lung returned back. Quite fortunate. Why fortunate? Because he was not of dream that we have to start out rule over Delhi. So simply by destroying and by taking lots of wealth, he returned back to Central Asia. From Samarkand he was there. So he returned back to Samarkand, but he appointed his noble to rule over Punjab. So he appointed a nominee over Punjab and returned back to Samarkand. This Mongol invasion made Delhi Sultanate almost weak. The capital was sacked, plundered, and you'll find that many time in history we are having threat, not directly, indirectly. Say the important region for India, that is the Afghanistan and northern side of Afghanistan. Whatever the attacks, they were gathered over this portion first, and then they entered in India. Try to recollect Alexander's invasion. If we were able to stop Alexander in this region, then India must be protected very easily in those days also. Alexander's invasion, or even later period, Scythian, Kushan, Hun, they were first carried out their work over this region, and then they entered. Only Scythian entered from Bolan Pass, otherwise all other invasions were carried out from Khyber Pass. Even Mohammad Ghaznavi, and say we have discussed a lot of history now, so you can able to trace out all these invaders. They were in this region first, they settled, and then they entered. Even Demetrius, Menandrus, all these people, they came from this region and then able to conquer. So this Afghanistan and certain parts of Central Asia, they were worked as base camp for attacks on India. Now these Mongols successfully attempt to ride Delhi. They were not able to penetrate still further, but from Delhi only they returned back by appointing a ruler on Punjab. Say here, I am giving just idea here that Firoz Shah Tughlaq was rule was ended 1388. Then no firm ruler was there. Under Taimurlung or Tamerlan, attack was carried out in 1398. Then till 1414, the dynasty survived, Tughlaq dynasty. Nasiruddin was last ruler of this Tughlaq dynasty. So founder Ghiyasuddin Tughlaq, the end Nasiruddin Tughlaq. Ghiyasuddin captured throne by defeating Nasiruddin, but that was different, Khushru Khan. And now the end was Nasiruddin again. And 1414 to 51, for this short period, Delhi was under rule of Mongols. Say, we had discussed that Taimurlung, while returning back, appointed a nominee over Punjab. That nominee captured the throne. He marched towards Delhi, already weakened. That means this is again Mongol invasion, but not from Central Asia, from Punjab only, because they were settled on Punjab region. And from Punjab, he marched till Delhi and ruled Delhi. That was the Sayyid dynasty that was very short-lived. That is from 1414 to 51. A short rule of Sayyid dynasty was there. They were of Mongol origin and they were ruled around 200 miles region of Delhi. So, India was not entirely under rule of Sayyid. Delhi and surrounding 200 miles area, that was under leadership of this Sayyid. Sayyid dynasty was not that much capable. They were not able to expand their empire all over India. They were not able to expand the ambition. They only run the machinery of empire as it was previously run by Firoz Shah Tughlaq and next rulers. So, this is all end of this foreign invader. See, first it was under Turki rule and now it was under Mongol rule. So, after Tughlaq, the Turki rule came to end completely. Say, Tughlaq were also not originally Turk, but some relation with Turk people were there. But now Mongols, they conquered the throne of Delhi, and ultimately a next capable dynasty ruled over Delhi, that was Lodhi dynasty. So from 1451 onwards, Delhi was ruled by Lodhi. Now Lodhi were Muslims, but of pure Afghan origin. I don't know how this pure Afghan origin word is used, but as it is used in books, I have to use. So, they were of pure Afghan origin. They are called as Pathan dynasty or Afghan dynasty. They ruled over Delhi. That is the end of Turki rule over India. And now, next rule that was of Afghan origin. Now, keep in mind, in ancient history also, Afghanistan, now we are calling it a separate nation, but it was part of India only. You are remembering that is called as Gandhar. Takshashila was its capital. Another capital was Pushkalavati or Pushpapur or Purushpur, that means somewhere around Peshawar. So these capitals were there of Afghanistan, or say rather Gandhar region. The Mahabharat, if you are considering that as history, then in that time also, the Shakuni from Gandhar tried to establish supremacy over great part of India. Actually, Gandhar was part of India also. Takshashila University, famous, that was also part of Indian University. But the region was Gandhar. Even the Swat Valley, if you are aware, somewhere around this Pakistan border, Afghanistan-Pakistan border, this region, that is called as Swat Valley. So, this Swat Valley, that was having their mother tongue as Sanskrit, and people were speaking Sanskrit in old days over there. But due to these foreign attacks, people converted, and now the Indianized rule over India that was there of Lodhi dynasty. Delhi was under rule of Lodhi dynasty. The ruling system was now changed out. So the Afghans having tribal character. This region of Afghanistan is there in mountain range Hindu Kush, a part of Himalaya only. And the people, they are having some tribal character. Today also, they are having Loya Jirga, like that tribal committees, they are there. So here also, they stressed out this tribal things or tribal principle, that partnership with Sultan. Sultan was not supreme. Sultan was partnered by these other nobles. So like that theory was there. The Bahlul Lodhi, he was ruler of this Punjab. He marched out to Delhi and ultimately conquered the throne. Now they were having some concept of ruling that is like tribal thing. The army was also now changed in these tribal principles, and ultimately they lost the supremacy of army. Now initially the Bahlul Lodhi was the founder member, the most effective ruler of this Lodhi dynasty, that was Sikandar Lodhi. He controlled entire Ganga Valley till Bengal. He was able to control. So once again Delhi Sultanate become prominent. Say from region around Delhi, they marched till Bengal, and the northern part or Gangetic Valley now under control of this Pathan or Afghan dynasty Sikandar Lodhi. He also changed out the capital from Delhi. He moved capital towards Agra, towards some southeast part, that to control empire more effectively. So I hope from Mahmud Tughlaq onwards, this fad was going on again and again, that to change out capital from Delhi to other part. The principle of heredity was given by Firoz Shah Tughlaq. The post, they were hereditary transferred to next generation. That principle or that practice was stopped by Lodhi dynasty. A council of people were there, and they used to decide the ablest ruler for next. So like that, the principle of heredity that was lost during this part. Then the last ruler of this dynasty, Ibrahim Khan Lodhi, he tried to gain supremacy. Rather, they were having problem, as we have discussed, the partnership, or we have to discuss, we have to deal with other people. But Ibrahim Khan Lodhi assumed entire rule. He collected all powers in his hand, and therefore increased the amount of enemies inside the palace. That was the problem of Ibrahim Khan Lodhi. And ultimately, this Lodhi dynasty came to end in 1526 by again a great personality. Again, that great personality belonged to Mongol people only. That was Zahiruddin al-Muhammad Babur. He was having mixture of great two dynasties or two great personalities. From mother's side, he belonged to Chengiz Khan. And from father's side, he was having origin of Taimurlung. So confluence of this Taimurlung and Chengiz Khan, that was there in Babur. And still, he was capable ruler. The terrific experience of war was there with him, and ultimate Mongols, that means highest cruel people. In history, you will find again and again, as we have discussed about Chengiz Khan, we have discussed about Hun, we have discussed about Taimurlung, the same that characters were there in this great personality Babur. He was ruler of Afghanistan. But before that, he was there in northern side of Afghanistan, that is Samarkand was the place. He tried to capture Samarkand again and again with constant failure. He became emperor from age of 11 but lost out territories. By successive failures, he entered in Afghanistan. And ultimately, he became king of Afghanistan. Later on, by making prominent power in Afghanistan, he tried to invade India. First, on the call of Lodhi dynasty only, Daulat Khan from Punjab, and then in order to defeat Ibrahim Khan Lodhi. The first battle of Panipat, in history you are aware that maximum battles in order to get supremacy over India, they are fought in the region of Panipat only. So try to recollect the Prithviraj Chauhan and Mohammad Ghori, the battle of Tarayan. If you are considering Mahabharata history, then Kurukshetra, then this battle of Panipat, even the Satvahan, they were defeated in Haryana region only by Kushan. So many battles they fought in this region in order to get supremacy over Delhi. So like that, now in history we are calling this is as first battle of Panipat, that was fought between Babur and Ibrahim Khan Lodhi. Different figures I am having from different books, but Babur was there along with somewhat 25,000 well-trained army, where Ibrahim Khan Lodhi was having somewhat around 1,25,000 army. The most important thing that Babur was having terrific experience of war and terrific ambition to control India, whereas Ibrahim Khan Lodhi was somewhat lazy ruler. The law and order was not there in his army, and ultimately on battle of Panipat, and in some book it is given as Rajput Rana, Rana Singh was there with Babur. In order to conquer Delhi, he was having ambition to control over Delhi. So initially he fought with Babur. I don't know whether this is true or not, but this is given. And ultimately the battle of Panipat, that was fought, Ibrahim Khan Lodhi was killed and Delhi was conquered by Babur. So again, okay, these Mongol rulers, Mongol riders, they were entering in India, and ultimately now this is last ride of Mongol, because ultimately they were able to conquer the throne successfully. The Babur conquered his throne and Mongol rule was established on India. The Pathan or Afghan dynasty came to end. No doubt that Babur was Mongol, but he was having some allergy of that word, some low category word, and so he used the word as Mughal. So henceforth we are calling these people as Mughal or Mughal. So this Mughal word was introduced, but with that name was not changed. Now they were not following Mongol language, they were using Turki language, because for so many years they ruled from, that means from Genghis Khan onwards, they ruled over Central Asia, that is called as now Turkestan or Turkmenistan. So they followed Turki and Persian language. They were all having affinity for Persian language, so they used Persian language, and the art and all the styles they belong, that was having influence of Persia. So Delhi was now under rule of Mongol. Now here we have to take a short break. So we have discussed from Mohammad Ghori to Ibrahim Khan Lodhi. This is first phase of Islamic attacks from different parts of world, especially Turkestan, then Mongolia, Afghanistan, these people, and Arab obviously, before Mohammad Ghori, the Mohammed bin Qasim. All these invaders, they were trying to expand their empire. But at end of this, that at 1526, we have to discuss what was the fact that no sultan except Alauddin Khilji, Mubarak Khan Khilji, No other sultan was able to control entire India in his hand. Jalaluddin Khilji realized that without taking help of local people, we are not able to rule, we are not able to enforce. Say, this is different observation in the world. So for example, these Islamic invaders, they invade Iran, that means Persia. And ultimately, they were able to rule out this Iran successfully. And Iran is, in nowadays, we are calling that as Islamic nation. No doubt Shia dominant nation is there, but still that is Islamic nation. Like that, they were not able to convert entire Indian population to Islam in old days. The reason that is not cleared in history, but as we are saying that Rana Sangh was there with Babur, that means still near Delhi only, he was ambitious to conquer Delhi. That means he was there in Rajputana. No doubt after Mohammad Ghori, entire Rajput kingdom were not came to end. They survived, they were having constant fight with these foreign invaders again and again. Keep in mind, Alauddin Khilji, Jalaluddin Khilji, they were fighting with Rana Hamir of that fort of Ranthambore that was there. That means the Rajput kingdoms were there and the South India remained untouched. As we have discussed, during rule of Mohammad Tughlaq, he conquered Warangal. But in his rule only, Warangal declared his independence. Same way, the South India that was freed and ultimately Vijayanagar Hindu Empire was formed. Then here, no doubt that Delhi Sultanate we are calling. But what was the size of Delhi Sultanate under Sayyid dynasty? Just 20 miles around Delhi. That means even less than an area of state in modern India. So historians, they are making some bad impression that India was under rule of foreign. No doubt Delhi was under rule of foreign. But the deciding, whatever we are calling the remaining territories, they were not under direct rule. For example, Bahamani kingdom. The Bahamani king, they were Islamic, Muslims, but they were not outsiders. Later on, Bahamani kingdom splits into five different kingdoms. Out of that, three were outsiders. The Adil Shah of Bijapur, Karnataka. The Adil Shah belonged to Turki race. Kutub Shah of Govalakonda, Andhra Pradesh. He belonged to Iranian class. Then Bidar was ruled by Barit Shah. Barit Shah was there from Georgia. So three rulers from Bahamani kingdom, they were outsiders. Whereas two, the Nizam Shah of Ahmednagar and Imad Shah of Vidarbha or Berar. So he was, both of them, they were originally Brahmin. From Vijayanagar Hindu Empire, they were taken as captives, converted to Islam. So, no doubt, all of five Bahamani pieces, they were Islamic. But out of that, two were indigenous and three, they were of outside origin. So, like that, entire outsider's rule was not there. India was ruled by outsiders from time to time. This statement is wrong. Parts of India were ruled by outsiders. This statement is right. Not entirely. So this is the thing we have to discuss. Now, we have to concentrate on trade, economy and other things during this Sultanate. And then we have to discuss the causes of downfall of Sultanate.